Well, thank you so much for being here today, and on behalf of the family, I want to thank you for your acts of kindness over these days and during this time of Lou's sickness, and we just appreciate you being here today. Of course, family, we're just so glad you can get together. Obviously, for this occasion, it's not what we want to get together for, but today we just want to honor Lou and honor the Lord, and she's an easy lady to talk about sweetly, isn't it? And we're going to hear some testimonies today and of her sweetness and what a precious person she is. Let's pray together and give thanks to the Lord and ask for his help today. Our Father, we thank you for loving us and preparing a place for us, and that is a comfort of our hearts today that we know where Lou is, and we ask you to have your hand upon this time we have together, that you would give comfort and encouragement and strength to the family and friends. And we ask this in Christ's name. Amen. And we will meet her again one day, won't we, Roy? I tell you. They're asking Roy about closing the casket at the end of the service. He says, I don't have a problem with that because I know where she's at. And that is a great comfort of the day. And that's what we're going to talk about. We know Lou is with the Lord. And I want to read from the obituary. It's so well put together and tells a lot about her and the family. And so I just want to read through it today. It's Lillie Jones Kessinger, 70, of Roanoke, Virginia, lovingly referred to as Lou. Passed away peacefully at home, surrounded by her family, on Monday, November 23rd, 2020. She was born in Ivanhoe, Virginia, on July 14th, 1950, to Lillian Gibbs Jones and Marvin Jones. And Jennifer had something to do with, I'm sure, so she was one tough cookie, and that was a way to say it, wasn't she? had to deal with a lot growing up, and then she had to deal with a lot later in life with some physical problems that she had. And she overcame a lot of odds growing up. She graduated from Jefferson High School in 1970. She began her career with Roanoke County Social Services in 1972. She loved her career in social work. She went above and beyond for her people during her 30-year career with Roanoke County, where she retired early at the age of 52 to what she most loved spending her time doing, and that was with her grandbabies, and she loved her family. We were talking about this, and she, you know, this is the one place she worked. Not many people work at one place their whole life, and this is what she spent her life doing. But her work was centered around people. And as the family was sharing with me, she called the people that she worked with her people because she had such a heart of compassion. She started out working with just one pair of shoes when she first started working and with a humble beginning. And I saw the notebook last night. If some of you saw the letters from all the people and the employees and people that just wrote such kind things about Lou, it was just really special to see. She was very much loved and loved the people that she worked with. She loved Jesus, Elvis, Mustangs, and her family. I remember when I first came here, it's been almost 15 years ago, Brenda and I saw, and later on, during that time, somewhere along the way, she got that Mustang. I don't remember exactly when it was. And I said, whose Mustang is that? And Roy said, that's Lou's Mustang. And she loved Mustangs. And by the way, a little known fact, maybe except for the family, that she also enjoyed drag racing a Ford Fairlane. That's right, drag racing. Can you see 4'11" Lou behind the wheel of a little Ford Fairlane drag racing? I mean, that's something else. She also enjoyed working in her flower beds filled with her favorite flowers, her trips to Goodwill auctions and antiquing, and she knew what days to go and loved buying things and reselling them and enjoying them. And in their house, there's a whole host of clocks as well. You always know what time it is at your place. And she was preceded in death by both parents, two brothers, Marvin E. Jones and John Jones, and one grandchild, Lillie Beamer. Left to cherish her memory are her devoted husband of 40 years, Roy, son and daughter-in-law, Kevin and Amai, and then daughter and son-in-law, Jennifer and Josh, and then stepdaughter and son-in-law, Julie and Tony, and a bunch of grandchildren. Some of them are here, and it's Jessica and Lexi and Justin and Garrett and Zach and Gabby and Grace and, let's see, and EJ and Mackenzie and JP and Macy. I think that's everybody. And one very special great-grandchild, and that's little Scarlett, and she's as cute as she can be. And then her faithful fur child and protector until the end, Little Blue. And he's not here today, but Little Blue was right by her side and loved her so much. Her sister, Elaine, and brother Tommy are here, and sister-in-law Vicky as well. And so, along with many nieces, nephews, and great nieces and nephews as well. And they also want to thank in this Good Samaritan Hospice for their loving and compassionate care. And hospice can be such a blessing at this point in life to help out with so many things. And so this is from the obituary. It just gives a snapshot of Lou.
Thank you.
I've had the joy of knowing Lou for a long time, but not like the family does. And I think it's always great to hear the family speak of their loved ones. And so, Roy, are you going to be first up today to say, share some things? You feel free to come up and share your heart, and we appreciate you so much. You want to come where they can go to speak from here? You okay?
Well, I'm trying to reflect back on the good times that me and Lou had. The very first time I met Lou was at a square dance. She was the cutest thing I'd ever seen. Leave me 6'1" and her 4'11". But we kind of hit it off, and a few times I, run into her maybe at the flea market or something, and finally we started dating. Then we got married, and that was a good time. We had a lot of fun together, raising good kids, good grandkids, and great grandbabies. She loved all of them. In fact, she loved everybody she met. And even after she retired, she started doing companion work to work with elderly people like she loved to do and the kids. She kept a scrapbook of all the children she had worked with in Lonoke County, and she called them her kids, which they were. It wasn't nothing for her to say, tell me, he said, well, this elderly lady needs some help on moving something on the weekend, so me and her would go do it. I mean, that's just the way she was. She had a big heart. I know she, the last few years she was really sick. And once she told me, she was in a lot of pain, and she said, hell could be no worse than the pain I'm in, but I'm not going to hell, I'm going to heaven. And that's where she went. I just want to know everybody know that she was, had a great heart and loved everybody. She loved her church family, and she loved you and Miss Nanny and everybody at church. And all I think about now, I'll just remember all the good memories that we had together and the good family we got. Thank you.
Amen. Thank you.
She was like one of a kind of mom. She was at every class party, every dance recital, everything that involved myself or my brother, t-ball, baseball, basketball. And then when my kids came along, she never missed anything. No matter how small it was or how big it was, she was always there. She was an ever-present person in everybody's life. She always called to check on people, and no matter what the need was, if it was there and she could take care of it, she would do it. Not because she had to, but because she wanted to. As far as not being a stranger, my dad and I will attest to, we have been driving down the road and she will stop. Somebody had gorgeous flowers in their flower bed, irises, roses, whatever, and she would have us stop the car. She would gladly go up to their door and knock on them and explain to them while she was there and asked them, could she have a snip of their flower for her flower garden? So her flower garden at our house has flowers from all over. Even she has David's, she brought back his hydrangea bush. She really did. She never met a stranger. She loved everybody. And she was just always there. And we have a million memories to last us a lifetime. And even though these are just a snip of the pictures, a lot of the pictures, some of them, she's not in. And that's because she was the one taking them. Because she was always there. Every family vacation, it's going to be hard, but I'm glad that she's no longer in pain, and I want to read this. It's, so go and run free. So go and run free with the angels. Dance around the golden clouds. For the Lord has chosen you to be with him, and we should feel nothing but proud. Although he has taken you from us, and our pain a lifetime will last, your memory will never escape us, but make us glad for the time we did have. Your face will always be hidden deep inside our hearts. Each precious moment you gave us shall never, ever depart. So go run free with the angels as they sing so tenderly. And please be sure to tell them to take good care of you from me.
Would someone else like to share? Yeah, Tom.
Well, I'm afraid to take you with my sister. She's a very good sister. I love her very much. And I will miss her forever. You know, I want to thank the world and Kenny and everybody else who helped care of her. They did an excellent job. Frank did her, and we kind of got better. So thank you, Lord. Thank you, Kenny. And everybody else, thank you. They were right here.
Amen. Anybody else?
Everybody needs a good friend, right?
She's a real friend to you.
Somebody else? A sweet testimony. It's nobody, I mean, it's family, you know. So this is like a family gathering with some friends added in, you know. So it's a chance to share. I'll give another opportunity, and then we'll have another song over here. There's great testimonies from all of you. Roy's yours, I don't know, but all of you, just really great. You don't, I mean, that caring, compassionate side of people is, I mean, it really makes a difference, doesn't it? Compassion makes a difference, impacts people's lives. And you just, people just really, really genuinely care. And you just sense that Lou just really, she just really cared, you know. And from your testimony, that's obviously true. And she, at the church, you know, she taught Sunday school and worked with Children's Church. And then when after she started getting sick, we still have snacks for the kids, and Roy, you and she would go and make sure that was all ready, and then you did it after she couldn't. She did it until she just couldn't do it anymore, you know. and just such a heart of compassion. Well, Garrett, we'll have that third song here. I just want to share a few verses of scripture with you this afternoon and out of 1 Thessalonians and just briefly, but in this chapter, in chapter number 4, it's really written for situations like this. I want to read verse number 18. This is at the very end of the chapter. It said, "Wherefore comfort one another with these words." This is how it ends. So what he says before this is meant to give us some comfort today. It's always difficult to know what to say at the end of someone's life. You know, you can't sum it all up in 30 minutes. It's just impossible. I mean, 70 years, such a full life, and she's touched, her life has touched so many. Luz has so many people, and obviously family. I mean, you know, you just never forget, and you don't want to forget. And that's what we have, memories. Isn't it great? All these photos. There's another whole stack of them back in the back, another frame of them in the lobby, and these two here, And all these photos represent memories. And thankfully, as long as we have memories, that's something we really hold on to. But there's something else that we hold on to, and that's what this passage speaks about, and that's the promises of the Lord. And I don't know everybody's testimony here, what your background is and all that. I know Roy and Luz and some of the family members. But God's promise here, and I want to read verse number 13, is that God provides real hope for us. Not a hope like I wish something happens, but a real confidence. That's what the word hope means in the Bible. It's an assured confidence. And he says in verse 13, "But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those which are asleep." And the word asleep here in the Bible means those who have passed on. He says that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. In other words, some people come to this day in the life of a loved one where they had no relationship with Christ, and they don't know what really happens, and they're just not, there's no God in their life at all. Jesus, nothing about Jesus, and there's just no, they think, well, this is just it. And Paul is the writer here, and he's saying, we don't need to be like that. We don't need to be like people that have no hope. He says, you need to sorrow. The Lord would never tell us not to sorrow over someone that's gone. But he says, don't sorrow like people that don't have any hope. And so his reminder here is that God's promises provide us a real confidence. And Roy said it over and over again. I know where she's at. And the confidence that he has in his heart, and the courage to face another day without his wife of all these years, is the fact that he knows he's going to see her again. And he knows where she's at. And he knows where he's going. And that is assurance that every family member and friend can have if you know the Lord. And so the first thing is God provides this promise of hope. In verse number 14, he says there is a reason to have hope. It's not just some general generic faith and some general generic hope. He says, here's exactly what has to take place. He says, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. And so he's saying here that believers in the Lord Jesus will go to be with Christ and live with him when they die. And so Lou today is not, her body is here, but she's with the Lord. The real Lou is with the Lord. And this is the promise. But he says that there's a condition to it, and that is if we believe that Jesus died and rose again. In other words, we put our faith and trust in Christ alone to save us. That's what the Rock of Ages, there's a part of that song that talked about the power of sin and the guilt of sin. There's a double cure from, and if you listen to the words of that great hymn, it was well chosen. And so the guilt and power of sin has to be taken care of, and that's through Jesus Christ. And Lou knew the Lord. She's not in heaven today because she's a good person. She's a good person. Do you know anybody more compassionate than Lou? But it's not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us. And so there was a time in Lou's life where she trusted the Lord Jesus Christ as her Savior. And today she's in heaven because of that, not because she was a good person, though she was a wonderful person. There's another great verse in 2 Corinthians that tells us about this as well. It's in chapter 5, and it says, if we're at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. All of us that are here today, other than Lou, we're at home in our body. So we're absent from the physical presence of the Lord. But in verse number 7, at the end of it, it says, rather, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Lou is the only one in this room today is absent from the body. And because she's absent from the body, she's present with the Lord. She's in the Lord's presence right now. And between now and the Lord comes back, and we don't know when the Lord is going to come back, she has an intermediate, she has a body. She's not a free-floating spirit around in heaven. She has a physical body right now. She's going to get a glorified body later, like we all will. But she is in the presence of the Lord, and her presence in the Lord is as real as our presence in this room today. Isn't that something if you think about it? You can look to your right and to your left and see a family member and see a friend, and as real as this is, and by the way, this is real, that is how real heaven and the presence of God is for Lou today. So when we think of it, think it in real concrete current terms that Lou is literally in the presence of God today. And that is part of what this comfort that Paul's talking about. That's where we get it, that we know where she's at. She's absent from the body and present with the Lord. Have you ever said, I think probably all of us have maybe said this, well, they're better off now. A person, particularly someone that's gone through suffering. And you know, Lou has battled with some very intricate health issues over the years, you know, some really complicated stuff. And at the end, we see our loved ones that are going through such difficult times, and we want them to be better off. And Paul said something like this himself. He said, it's okay for us to say that. He says, I'm in a strait betwixt two. I'm kind of stuck in the middle. He said, I said, having a desire to depart and to be with Christ, which is far better. So we're saying the right thing when we say today that Lou is better off because physically she came to a part of the battle where life was such a struggle. And so today, with a renewed body and in the presence of the Lord, she truly is better off. And Paul said the same thing. That does not mean that her physical presence is not missed. It just means that physically she's better off today. There's something else that comes to this when you think about people that have such sickness and go through a tough time physically. In Revelation chapter 21, it describes at the end of time, with a new heaven, a new earth, the Bible talks about what is eternity going to be like for all of us if you know the Lord. And here's the description of it. This is a great description. The Bible says all tears, that God's going to wipe all tears from their eyes. No more sorrow. And the fact is, he says no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And it's great to know that for all eternity there's no more suffering, no more funerals, no more death, no more sorrow, no more pain, no more emotional pain as well as physical pain. This is the promise of the Lord. And this is that confidence and the hope that Paul was talking about. The last thing I want to share with you is in verse number 17. He says, he's talking about when the Lord comes back, and he says, then we which are alive and remain are going to be caught up together to meet the Lord in the clouds. This is talking about the rapture. This is talking about when the Lord comes back, and we don't know when that's going to happen, but it's promised all through the scriptures. And he says, one day the Lord's going to come back. And he says, we're going to meet the Lord in the air, and we're going to ever be with the Lord. And the Bible says the dead in Christ rise first, and we which are alive and remain are caught up to meet the Lord in the air. The big promise here is this, is that we will ever be with the Lord. You know what this means? That believers are going to be reunited with other believers. I think we would say confidently that in Lou's moments towards the end where she knew what was taking place, that she had this overwhelming joy in her heart that she knew the family members that knew and friends that knew Christ, that she was going to see you again. That this wasn't a final goodbye. That it was, you know, this was a transition, but that she was going to see family members and friends again that knew Christ. Which would remind us, if there's someone that doesn't know the Lord, that you need to be saved and trust Christ as Savior so you can see Lou again, because we are going to be reunited. So that last promise is that believers are going to be reunited with other believers. So we get to see each other again. Isn't that marvelous to think of it? Though our relationships will be some different, we will still recognize one another in heaven and know one another. And can you imagine a day, as real as it is for us, walking around and greeting each other and calling each other by name and knowing one another, that heaven's not just something in your imagination, that it's something real and is as real as you and I being here today, and that you get a chance, Roy, to see Lou again. We get to see the people that we love again. This is a marvelous promise. And so that's why Paul comes to the end and he says, take all these promises together. You look at all these things. He says, this is her. You need to comfort yourselves with this. Don't sorrow like those that have no hope. Comfort. Take comfort that you know where Lou is and where believers are. What did she write in the Bible? Didn't she give the kids and grandkids both have a Bible, right? And what phrase did she write in that? I think I saw one of those Bibles here. Did I see that Bible here with one of the grandkids? In that Bible, she says, waiting for you on the other side. Is that right? So Lou, everything I just said, I'm just saying what she said. And she's just saying what the Lord said, that she'll see you on the other side. And that's why we don't sorrow like those that have no hope. And you know, I know you all, the family members, know Lou way better than I do. But I think I can be confident about this. I think I can be really confident that Lou would want to make sure that you know where you're going, that she will see you on the other side. I know she desired that more than anything because she loved you. She obviously loved this. She loved her family. She wants to see you in heaven. Would you bow with me? We'll pray together. I want you to think with our heads bowed and eyes closed today, if you don't have a personal relationship with the Lord, I'd like you to catch me and grab me and just say, hey, Pastor, I'd like to talk about it. And you need to be settled on that decision of knowing Christ. And settle it today. Don't wait. Our Father, we want to thank you today for your precious word that does give us confidence and hope that we know where Lou is today. And Lord, I ask you to meet the needs of those that are here, that you would comfort their hearts. I know there are lots of believers here, that you would, by your Holy Spirit, just comfort and give exactly what they need and encourage them in these days and weeks ahead. And I pray for Brother Roy today that you would minister to him and all the family, that you would just, they would sense your presence and your nearness and your, that you'd be so real to them and just give them what they need today. Thank you for a life well lived by Lou and the lesson on compassion that we learned from her. And would you help us, dear Lord, to be that kind of a people, a compassionate people. And we ask this in Christ's name. Amen.